Look at this series, we're going to see the biblical characteristics of a fool. Now let me say again, I am not calling you a fool if you are doing what is applying to you. God is.
Amen.
Right? I'm just reading His Word. I didn't write it. I didn't make it up. It's inspired, and I'm just sharing it. So don't shoot the messenger and go home and tell everybody that Pastor T.R. is calling everyone a fool. But hey, I'm not doing it. Right? But again, we look at Psalm 14. It says, fools say to themselves, there is no God. They sin and commit evil deeds. None of them does what is right. So we've been talking about how that's the foundation. First of all, fools don't acknowledge the activity of God in their lives. So if you are living as if God does not care and if God is not aware, then you are playing the part of a fool. I was looking the other day on Facebook. I have a good friend of mine that put a status, do you believe in God? If so, why? And just kind of. So there, I was reading through these comments, and there's a lot of different comments, and a lot of people were saying, you know, yes, I believe in God, but He can't be defined, and He's not known, and He's in everything. And I'm like, so I put on there, yes, I believe in God. He is the creator of heaven and earth. He desires to be known. And creation points to us knowing Him. For all these people that want to say God is in the tree or the rock or whatever. Yeah, God created that tree and that rock. And one person put on there, if God existed and is the highest power, what created Him? I'm thinking, nothing. No, if He is the ultimate creating power, He Himself is eternal and never created, right? I didn't want to get into a Facebook argument, so I just put mine. A couple people later, then there's a lady that did. She just put it flat out there and said, I believe in God. He is expressed in a Trinity. He sent His Son Jesus to pay the price because we all have sinned, thanks to Eve. And she just put the gospel plan right there. And so I was like, yep, I'm going to like your status. That's what I believe too. And so, you know, a lot of people live as if God is not aware of their activities. And the Bible says they are fools. So how do we avoid the trap of becoming a fool? Our theme verse from Proverbs, 13:20, says, the one who associates with the wise grows wise, but a companion of fools suffers harm. Right?
Yeah.
The companion of fools suffers harm. And Mr. T puts it for you.
Go ahead and roll Mr. T's clip there, if you would, please.
No, I don't hate that boy, but I pity the fool, and I will destroy any man who tries to take what I got.
What's your prediction for the fight, then?
Prediction?
Yes, prediction.
Pain.
So again, you hang out with fools, you're setting yourself up for, as Mr. T says, pain, right? So last week, again, we talked about the foundation of a fool. The fool's foundation is uncertain because they refuse to listen to and obey the words of Christ. The wise man's foundation is set on a solid rock because he listens to and obeys the truth of Christ. So to avoid being a fool, we need to say, what does the Bible say? And I'm going to do it. And that's where we lay our foundation. I've always loved, anybody like Calvin and Hobbes comics? I've always been a Calvin and Hobbes fan. I don't know what it is about their you know, banter or whatever. I actually have somewhere in my little collection the last Sunday Calvin and Hobbes comic that was printed, I think, in 96, I think, is when Calvin and Hobbes stopped being a regular. But I found this comic, if you could pull up that Calvin and Hobbes comic. And if you can't read that, Calvin is saying, I can never enjoy Sundays because in the back of my mind, I always know I've got to go to school the next day. It's like trying to enjoy your last meal before the execution. And then Hobbes is just thinking, and then he says, a penny for your thoughts. Sorry. My thoughts are a buck a piece. A dollar? That's outrageous. Your thoughts aren't worth that. This one is a dollar. It's the bargain of a lifetime. I wouldn't pay a nickel for any thought you've ever had in your whole flea-ridden existence. That little remark just made the price $10. $10? You can't extort me by keep your stupid thought. If you knew what this was, you'd be you'd pay $10 for it. Come on, just tell me what it is, will you? Nothing doing, pal. Okay, I'll give you 25 cents. That's all I've got. That's all I have. Let's see it. Here, 25 cents. Now, what's the big expensive thought of yours? A fool and his money are soon, and then the fight ensues. So we've all heard that phrase before. The fool and his money are soon parted, if he had a chance to finish that quote, is what it would have said. And in case you are wondering if that is a true statement, I found this little tidbit on the internet as well. Anybody know who Kanye West is? Kanye West is a bit of a crazy rap hip-hop dude. And, I think he's mentally crazy, insane. But he decided to design a white T-shirt that is plain. The price on a Kanye West T-shirt, $120. The article below says this. Poet Thomas Tusser famously said, "A fool and his money are soon parted." So that's where it came from. Thomas Tusser said that. But it took a $120 plain white T-shirt designed by Kanye West with French design house APC to prove just how many fools exist. Priced at roughly a gazillion times the cost of a regular white T-shirt, this Egyptian cotton hip-hop T-shirt bears no visible difference from a dollar store tee. Other than the words APC Kanye silkscreened on the inner neckline, of course, letting only the wearer know how willing he is to throw his money down the toilet. But despite the exorbitant price and the simplistic design, the Kanye T-shirt sold out upon its debut, along with $265 jeans and $280 hoodies. I'm pretty sure that my entire clothing budget for the year is less than $265 pair of jeans. Why? Because I shop at thrift stores whenever possible. I thought about wearing one of my suits today. I have a couple of thrift store suits that in grand total for two suits, a off-white one and a black one, I paid to purchase those suits less than $30. All right. One of them needed some, the pants were too short and they had an extra long hem inside. And with my own two crafty hands, I took the hem out and re-hemmed them down and then repressed them to where they were long enough for my legs versus this other person. Right. So I'm thrifty. My wife would say I'm cheap, but I prefer the term thrifty. But that proves a fool and his money are soon parted. When someone's willing to say that this T-shirt is worth $120 of my time. Now, we went out to dinner with my parents a while back, and my dad picked up the tab for all. It was a bunch of us, a lot of us at this buffet. And my kids were kind of amazed. And so he just told them how many hours he had to work to pay for that meal. And so it's equating in their minds hours worked equals money earned equals being able to buy stuff. So now sometimes they'll ask how much something is, and it takes me a lot more hours to work versus my dad's salary working at a nuclear power plant. But I can tell them it costs this much. Now for me, I have to work this many days to pay for that. And so I'm equating to them the value of money. That money is really just what somebody's willing to give you for your time and energy and services, right? That's what it is. We just put it on paper and said it's worth something, but that's what it equates to. And we have to realize if we want to have something, we have to stop acting like the fools that throw down $1,000 for a Kanye West outfit, right? Dave Ramsey says, if you want to be rich, start doing what rich people do. Now, Mel and I, in our early years of marriage, kind of took that the wrong way. We had a number of friends that were business owners and had a lot of money, and they would do stuff like go out to dinner regularly, and we would say, we want to come along. And then before we knew it, we found ourselves about $25,000 in credit card debt. And then I had to say, I can't live like I have money like you guys do because I don't have the money you guys do. And then I had to go to my father and say, I need some help. I'm never going to get out from under this. because they're charging me like 23% interest on this $25,000. It's going to take me forever to get out of debt. And he said, all right, you got to stop using that card and you got to knuckle down. I'm going to help you get a loan. I'll co-sign for it. That's not a good plan either. But he was willing to do something foolish to help me. And he said, and you're going to pay that off in 5 years. That's $525 a month for 5 years to pay off stuff that I wasn't enjoying anymore because it had already passed through my system and gone down the toilet, most of it. That's how foolish it was. That's how stupid I was being. That's why when I talked to Chris Chandler about his ideas of his future, I said, you need to go through Financial Peace University now. Because I know you know a lot of this stuff because your parents have taught you a lot of this stuff. But if you want to have a hope of a future with a wife that you can take care of, you need to learn how to take care of your finances. Because when you walk with the wise, you grow wise. But if you're hanging around fools, you're setting yourself up for pain. You see, here's some things rich people don't do, all right? Rich people do not go to payday lenders. Come with me any day of the week, because I drive through most of Johnson County every day of the week. We will go to Leawood and see how many payday lenders we can find. And then we'll drive through and see how many multi-hundred-thousand-dollar homes we drive past. $500,000-$600,000 homes, pools in the back, big play areas for their kids, nice cars in the driveway. Wonder why the payday lenders don't set up shop around here. These people got some money. Because they don't go there. That's why. So if you want to someday have something to put your name on, stop going to these places. Let me tell you something else. Rich people don't spend more than they make if they want to stay rich. How many of us have heard the story of the guy that got the multi-million dollar signing deal to play baseball or basketball or football? Or he was paid millions to sing or be in a band. And the other day I flipped past on MTV Cribs, and they passed one of these rap stars. Redman is his name. And he lives in a shabby little house that was dirty and piled with garbage, and just the kitchen was a mess. And they went back a few years later, and it was still the shabby little house. He had just put some new cabinets in his kitchen and picked up his trash. But this guy's getting paid money selling albums. He and Method Man are doing what they got to do because they want the dollar bill, y'all. And he's got nothing to show for it because he spent more than he made at some point, right? Rich people don't do that if they want to stay that way. Rich people don't borrow on things that lose value, all right? I listen to Dave Ramsey almost every morning, and this guy had millions of dollars in his early years, but he also had millions in debt. He went bankrupt, and he said, I'm not going to borrow on things anymore, and he started living his life based off the cash that he had in his hand, and now he's got millions of dollars again, and he says, you know what? I don't go out and buy, He doesn't go buy a brand new car. Mark's a used car salesman, so you can go see him, and he'll get you a good deal on a used vehicle. Why? Because as soon as you drive that car off the lot, you lose, what, 20% of its value? The moment it crosses off of that dealer's 20%. So if you want to take 20% of your money and flush it down the toilet, and you're okay doing that, if you got the money to spare, that's some rich people do. Some rich people can go out and afford to buy a new car every few years, and they don't care about the lost value. They don't want the hassle, and so they can do that, and hey, that's their money, that's their choice. But me, I can't afford to lose 20% of the value of something the moment I put my butt in the seat, right? I can't afford to do that. I get mad when I lose $5. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, I knew I had that dollar in my pocket somewhere. I will tear my car apart for a quarter. You know, it was in my pocket just now. I wanted to get a candy out of that candy machine over there. No, it was somewhere around here, right? That's some things that rich people don't do. So if you want to have something, start doing these things. Don't live your life like you got money, but start following the habits that led that person to that. Why? Because these people had the wisdom to make some choices that were positive that led to a better future, right? And we need to start living that way. And you might be sitting here thinking, well, Pastor T.R., we're in church, and you're talking a lot about money. You guys know the Bible talks more about money than salvation? Uh-oh, what? You look up, I have a website I like to go to regularly. And all you have to do is Google search, what does the Bible say about money? And it brings you to this website that is ChristianPFPersonalFinance.com. And this guy has gone through and listed out all the scriptures by topic of what the Bible says about money, doing business, earning a living, saving, giving. And you can look, stewardship, right there. It'll take you to a whole list of verses. And it is massive. I can't even pull it up on my tablet because I run out of page space as I'm scrolling through to look at stuff. It's a lot of verses that talk about money. So if God is saying that much about money, should we not pay attention to what God is saying? Now, let me tell you this. The Bible does not say this. God wants you to be healthy, wealthy, and wise. Uh-oh. I'm sure the Bible says God wants me to be happy. And you know what would make me happy? A brand new 65-inch TV in my living room. So God, therefore, wants me to have that TV in my living room. No, the Bible nowhere says that God wants you to be happy. The Bible does say that God wants you to have joy and that the joy of the Lord is my strength. But joy is something that is inside you, and it doesn't change when the circumstances around you are different. Right? And the Bible does not say that God wants you to be rich. And you can flip the TV on, and there's a lot of preachers out there saying, God wants you to be rich, and I want you to put seed money into my ministry, and God is going to give it back 100-fold. And no, those guys are taking scripture out of context. Because for the gospel to be true, it's got to work everywhere. And I challenge them to go to the most poverty-stricken places on this planet, the third world countries in Africa and Southeast Asia and Central and South America, and preach that gospel and see how many people hang around. Because when people are doing everything they can to get a bowl of rice at the end of the night, they're not thinking about giving you $100 towards your ministry. That's called the prosperity gospel, and it is a false doctrine, people. If you are listening to somebody that is preaching a prosperity gospel, I encourage you strongly to shut that voice off. Because the Bible says if you want to grow wise, walk with the wise, but a companion of fools suffers harm. And when you're letting that person speak into your life, you're setting yourself up for harm. That is truth. That is gospel. Nowhere in the Bible does God say he wants you to be rich. You know what he says? Jesus says, if you're faithful in the few things, I will make you master of much. If I can't control the $10 I got in my pocket, God is not going to give me 1,000 to mismanage, right? If I'm going to say, God, you're my provider, you're my source, I'm going to be faithful in the little things and trust you for the rest. That's what the Bible says. That is gospel. God doesn't promise wealth, but he does teach us how to wisely manage what we have from his word. The Bible never says that we are owners. All through Scripture, we are called stewards. Not a Stewart, like my last name, but a steward with a D on the end. And a steward was somebody that was put in charge of the affairs of a house. Joseph, in the Old Testament, was the steward of Potiphar's home. Potiphar didn't worry about anything in his home because Joseph was managing things and God was blessing the management of Joseph. And it came to the point even that Potiphar's wife came and said, hey, Joseph, come on, you know, let's go in the back. And he said, no, my master is trusting me with everything in his house and I'm not going to disrespect him by laying a finger on you. I'm out. Right? What happened to Joseph? He went to prison. What? Oh, my goodness, God, what are you doing to Joseph? He's being faithful. He's doing the right thing. God had a bigger plan in store for Joseph, and he said, I'm going to take you from the prison to the palace. You're going to go out of the prison, and you're going to be second in command over all of Egypt, only answering to Pharaoh. And God did that to save his people because Joseph was a faithful steward. He didn't own anything. And you and I don't own anything. In fact, the Bible says the earth is the Lord's and what? Everything in it. God owns it all. I'm just managing what he's putting in my hand. If that's $5, if that's $10, if it's $1,000, if it's $1,000,000, it's God's. I'm just going to manage it. So the Bible gives us some principles to manage the resources that God places into our lives. And the first thing that we see that I want you to take home today is this. Fools don't save. Fools don't save. Proverbs 21:20 says, there is a desirable treasure in olive oil in the dwelling of the wise, but a foolish man devours all he has. So if you go to the wise man's house, the Bible is saying that you'll go and find a pantry that's got stuff that you can eat and enjoy. But if you go to the fool's house, the cupboards are bare because they've devoured everything. Now, there are times all of our cupboards get bare, sort of. You know, we all have the day we have to go buy groceries because we've eaten everything else in the house. That's not saying you're a fool. As long as you've got the resources to get some more groceries into your house, right? It says that fools devour all they have. Fools find themselves living paycheck to paycheck, guilty, right? I'm not saying I've attained it. I'm not perfect. I'm saying we're going to learn some things that will make us grow with the wise, right? Fools live on more than they try to live on more than they make, which puts them further behind, which makes them more reliant on getting that next paycheck to have anything, right? Because fools don't save. If you want to be wise, learn to live on less than you make. What can I take out of what I'm currently doing and still survive so that I've got a little bit extra for the next week? How can I take a little bit now and save for later? You see, I've been in ministry now 13 years. January marked 13 years of ministry, and every trip I've ever taken students on, I always have at least one student that their parent comes to me before the trip and says, will you hold Johnny's money? As if I didn't have enough responsibility on this trip already, keeping track of permission slips and emergency contact numbers and the money we got to pay for the hotel or the event or whatever. Can you keep Johnny's money for him? Why do you want me to keep Johnny's money? Because Johnny will spend it all at the first stop you get. And I know you guys are going to be gone for 3 days, and you've got to buy some meals going, and you got to get some meals coming back. And Johnny won't have any money coming back if you don't hold on to his money and give him what he needs. And I put that in my mind. I said, let me teach my children how to manage their money so they don't go to their youth pastor someday and say, can you hold my money because I'll spend it all. And we think that's just a naive, impulsive kid. But a lot of us live the same way. As soon as I get something, spend it. I don't know how many times when I was working at Sam's, I would see people come through the line with a basket loaded high. And they would take they'd ring it all up, and they pull out their EBT card, and they'd slide it through. I got to get this. I got to get all of this stuff. And I'm thinking, how much of that stuff is going to get wasted? How much of that stuff is going to get forgotten? Because you're trying to think a month in advance, and you don't have your life together enough right now to take care of what you got to do because you're relying on Uncle Sam to bail you out. Maybe take that amount and budget. I'm not saying anything. I've had to be on food stamps since I've been here. I'm not saying I'm better than anybody, okay? I'll just let you in on a little tidbit here. When they stopped doing the after-school program, I had no other option to put food on my table. I had no other backup job. I had to go on food stamps for about 9 months. And I said, I don't want to live that way anymore. And whatever I got to do, I'm not going to live that way anymore. So that's why I've worked 2 and 3 jobs. Because I said, I'm not going to go back on Uncle Sam's dime. Because that's me. I don't think that's the way the Bible tells us to live. So I'm not going to do it. I'm not saying anything against anybody that is. You got to deal with the Lord and you about that. But the Bible says in the house of the wise are treasures of food and oil. In the house of the fool, he devours everything he has. God wants you to set aside and save. God wants you to work towards a better future. That's what he wants you to do. Now, I take that kid, you know, every trip I've ever been on, spend all their money, come to the trip home, we stop at McDonald's. Pastor T, I don't have any money. I'm really hungry. So I take out of my pocket, all right, you got to order off the dollar menu. If I'm paying for it, you can get 3 items off the dollar menu, and that's what you get because you didn't save any of your money for the trip home. Now, 13 years later, I don't go on a trip without expecting that there's going to be at least one child that is going to be without money. So I plan ahead, and I stick an extra 10 or 20 bucks in my pocket. So when we get to the McDonald's at the end of the trip, now everybody knows Pastor TR always has an extra 10 or 20 bucks in his pocket when we go on trips, because somebody's going to have spent all their money on candy at the first stop and not have any money for some real food at the end. And so now I say, I'm going to be wise about this and plan ahead. Because money burns the hole in too many people's pockets. Proverbs 24, verses 3 and 4. I'm getting on, stepping on some toes, I think, today. So let's move on. Proverbs 24, verses 3 and 4 says, by wisdom a house is built, and through understanding it is established. By knowledge its rooms are filled with all kinds of precious and pleasing treasures. Look at those words. Wisdom, understanding, and I forgot to underline it, knowledge. It is not by just the silver spoon that you were born with in your mouth that you have something right now. No. Because my parents raised 5 children in a home where my dad owned his own business, and it was an automotive business. And so if you know anything about automotive business, it goes like a roller coaster. It's like, I got lots of customers, lots of cars. I got no customers, no cars, lots of customers. And it goes up and down. And then he would have people who would come in and want their car fixed, and they wouldn't pay him. And so he would keep their car, and that's how all 5 of us got something to drive when we got to be old enough, because he would have these cars. Well, this guy didn't pay it. The time's up. The state gives me the title, and now it's your car to drive. You know, you got to put gas in it. And so that's how we were raised. And I remember my mom wanted to be a teacher, so she went to school during the day, and at night she worked at Kmart with 5 kids at home. She would take Saturdays, and she would plan a week's worth of meals. And she would cook up all these things that just had to be thrown in the oven. And so you'd look in our freezer, and it'd be stacks of prepared meals, because mom was either at school, studying, or at work to make sure that we had enough food on the table so that we could have a better future, right? And so we would take out the meal, read the instructions on the top, take the plastic, stick it in, and we would feed ourselves. Why? Because they were working towards something better. We had very meager beginnings, and now she's the principal of the school. And my dad has the building and is renting it out to another place that's doing all their, a car dealership that does all their detailing in his shop, right? And he saved one stall so he can take his cars there still and fix them, because he still drives the same car that he's driven for, I don't know, 10 years. He just fixes it and keeps driving it. Even though he's got the money to pay cash for a new one, he says, this one's still good. It does what it needs to do, right? That's how a wise person lives. But he didn't just get there because he just was born that way, and everything was given to him, and he got a trust fund that just dumped into his lap. No, he had some wisdom, some knowledge, and some understanding that helped him take the steps to get there. Now, I can't today, in the little bit of time we have left, give you all the wisdom, knowledge, and understanding that you need, because I'm still learning it too, right? I have not yet arrived. Don't think that Pastor TR has got it all together. I still make some dumb mistakes financially frequently, right? Come on. But I'm saying, Lord, show me what I need to do so I can have a better future for my children, so I can teach them what they need to handle what you're giving them and you're entrusting to them. The first thing I think that we could say, again, if you want to be wise in your finances, listen to Dave Ramsey on the radio, okay, every morning, KCMO, talk radio, 103.7, 710 AM. And you can listen from 10 until 11, I think, or 9 to 11. Listen to good old Dave Ramsey. If you miss it, you can listen to him on iHeartRadio like 24 hours a day. You can go on his website and watch his live show 24 hours a day. It's always playing. Any of those ways, you can learn some financial wisdom. But this is the stuff that I've learned from listening to him, from going through Financial Peace University. And this is from God's Word, right? Now, he says, if you want to walk with the wise and grow wise, he says, in the house of the wise are stores of treasure and food, then the first thing you need to do is make a written budget. That's some knowledge, wisdom, and understanding that you need in your life. Make a written budget. In fact, just this week, Jen and I were talking about it, and I was telling her how my written budget is a spreadsheet. On one column, I have the names of things, whether they be income names, the sources of my income, or my expenses, they're all there. And the next column, at the beginning of the month, I sit down, or actually at the end of the previous month, I just did this on Friday, the 31st for February. I said, here's what I'm expecting my income to be from these sources. My expectation. This is how much money I have to work with. And then I go down the list. These are my expenses this month, and this is what I expect them to be. Okay, I get my utility bills. Well, I don't have to expect. I know that my utility bills are going to cost me this much money. X number of dollars. 287, whatever it is. So I put that in the column, and then nice of Excel, it makes me not have to do any math. It just adds up all my income and gives me a total, and then it adds up all my expenses and subtracts it from that total. And then I go to the very bottom column, and I see if there's I'm hoping for a plus when I get to the bottom. Sometimes there's a minus when I get to the bottom. Then I have to go back in and say, okay, what's going to be cut? Where can I shave some money so that that hits, preferably zero at the end of my month? Right? Do I need to take some money out of my gas budget? Maybe I need to drive a little bit less. Maybe, you know what? Rather than eating a roast for Sunday, we're going to have roast beef sandwiches because they cost a little bit less. Right? And I go through and we trim, and Mel and I talk about it. I say, okay, here's our fixed stuff. We know this is never changing every month. Our cell phone bill's the same every month. Our mortgage is the same. Pretty much within a few dollars every month, our utilities are the same. So we don't even have to really discuss that. We go down to our things that change each month, how much spending money we might have, you know, how much money we're going to be able to put into savings this month. And we talk about those things so that at the bottom of that column, we say, okay. And then my third column, as I'm going through my month, I take my receipts and I plug them into those categories so I can see a running total of this is what my budget is. Here's the name. Here's my budget. Here's how much I've spent so far. So when it's time for Mel to go get some more groceries, I say, we've got this much money left in our grocery budget for this month. We've got to somehow make it stretch. And throughout every week, we talk about that. We look at that. We say, okay, this is the plan that we have. I make a plan for my money before I even get it so that I tell those dollars where to go. There's been times that many years of my life, I just look back and I think, where did all that money go? I make pretty good money at my job, and I have nothing to show for it. And then I know I'm not the only one, because when I'm listening to Dave Ramsey on the radio, and he says to the person they call in, I've got this debt, I think I need to file bankruptcy, and he starts talking about, okay, how much do you make? Well, I make $35,000 a year. Okay, but my wife makes $50,000 a year, and I'm like, wait a second, come on, that's $85,000. Unless you're living in Los Angeles or San Diego, you ought to be doing all right. And he's, okay, what are your debts? What are your expenses? How much is your rent or mortgage payment? And he starts asking them the simple questions. And then he gets down to the very bottom, and they want to file bankruptcy on like $2,000 of credit card debt that they've got. He's like, no, stop going out to eat all the time. Write down where your money's going to go, and you'll be able to pay that off in like 3 months because you make a really good income. You just are not in control of where your money's going. And that's the wisdom, that's the knowledge, that's the understanding that you and I need to get ahead. Make a written budget. Start saving for an emergency. How many of you guys know emergencies happen? Yes? Friday, was I expecting to slide into a curb and take a big chunk out of the sidewall of my tire? No. What do I need to do? Find a used tire to slap on there and keep driving, right? How many of you guys know I'm not freaking out about it because I know a used tire shouldn't cost me more than like $30. And what? I got an emergency account. I can take $30 out of it and I can pay for my new tire. Why? Because emergencies happen. Bad stuff happens. Know that it's going to happen rather than living like it's not going to happen and plan ahead. Isn't that what the Bible says the wise do? They plan? Yes? All right, we'll keep going. Write down your debts. Smallest to largest, and make minimum payments on the bigger ones and attack the smaller ones as much as you can. This is what Dave Ramsey calls the snowball. The debt snowball. Why? Because you're making these payments, all these payments. Say you got a $500 credit card and a $1,000 doctor bill, and you owe $8,000 on a car. And he says, okay, those are your order. You're making payments. Make minimum payments on the other ones and attack that big one, or attack that small one. Once it's paid off, take the money that you were paying for that one and apply it to the next one, so your next biggest one's going to get paid off even faster. And then when you get to that real big one, now you've got the payments that you were making on two smaller ones, and you're going to apply that to the big one, and then that's going to come off even faster. Now, sometimes to get to this point, to save a little something or to start this payoff, you know what you can do? Go around your house and look for stuff you don't use. How many of you guys have stuff in your house you don't use? Come on. Every one of us has a junk drawer or a junk garage or a junk shed, right? We're all there. So find something that you can sell. I'm amazed at what people try and sell. Anybody ever just look at Craigslist at what people are trying to sell? Craigslist is like Craigslist here in Kansas City works well because it's a big metro, lots of people. I'm just amazed. I'll find stuff that I thought I wanted, and then I don't want it. And then I'm like, I don't know, put it on Craigslist, see what happens. And like sometimes within hours of putting it on Craigslist, I have a buyer. Hey, can I come get that thing you're wanting to sell? And I'm like, yeah, you can. You got some cash? I also take credit cards via my Square account on my, you know, or debit cards. You know, find something to sell. Sometimes when Mark and Jen got married, we didn't really have the money at the time to go to Michigan. So you know what we did? We had a big garage sale. And it more than paid for our trip to Michigan. Right? And just look for stuff to sell. You don't have to have a garage sale, put on Craigslist. Find something to sell to get ahead, to set that money aside for future plans, to get out of debt. Why do you want to be out of debt? What's a big deal? Why do people talk about being debt-free? Well, Proverbs 22:7 says this, the rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender. Some translations say the borrower is slave to the lender, right? Because you know what? I owe money on my house. I have a mortgage. If I decide to not pay that mortgage, Brother Ted, what's going to happen? The bank's going to come and take my house. So I am, in essence, a slave to U.S. Bank as long as they hold the note on my house if I want to live in my house, right? Some of us are a slave to the credit union, to the payday lender, to all these different people. Where all these people, they tell us where our money's going because we have borrowed and borrowed and borrowed, right? So we should work towards not borrowing anymore. Plan for your future. Once you're debt-free, you have a more ability to do three important things: to give, to spend, and to save. Now, giving, the Bible talks a lot about us giving our tithes and our offerings. We talked about Paul thanking the church, writing to the Philippians about the gift while he was ministering in Thessalonica. Giving is important. Just because you're in debt, I'm not going to stop my giving. Unfortunately, because I am in debt, I can't give the way that I want to give, right? A few years ago, we went to Belize, and after coming back from Belize, I really felt burdened to help out this pastor and his family, a minister in this very poor country. And so Mel and I talked about it, and for about a year, we would send $50 a month to help support the pastor and his family in Belize. Because we wanted to continue, even though we had spent a week there and they were very hospitable and we got to minister with them, I wanted to continue that ministry opportunity with them, so we gave. And you know what? When I came to the point where I said, I don't even have the money to pay my utilities, the Bible says that you got to take care of your house, right? So I had a higher calling of responsibility to take care of the needs of my house before I could give above and beyond my tithes and my offerings to support missions. Right? So that's what the Bible teaches. Take care of the needs of your house, but not at the expense of your tithes. Right? The Bible says in Malachi 3, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house, says the Lord. Test me in this and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out a blessing that you cannot contain. Right? That's the promise of the tithe, and that is pre-law. We see that Joseph said, Abraham gave the tithe to Melchizedek, and Abraham's grandson Not Joseph. I lost it. Jacob. Thank you, other Jay. Jacob, on his way to find his wife, said, I will come back here and I will build a house for the Lord and I will give him a tenth of all. It's pre-law. So don't tell me that tithe is Old Testament law. No, it's pre-law. It applies to us. We should give, but we should give more than the tithe. We should give above an abundant offering, a joyful offering. That's what Paul talks about in Corinthians. He's talking to the church in Corinth. He says, when you bring your tithe, come joyfully and bring it. But do you know also Paul talks about? Think about what you're going to give. Before it comes time to take that offering, at the beginning of the week, set aside a sum of money to give. So do you know what I do? I take that literal. When I get my check and I record my check, I write my tithe check, and then I carry it in my wallet until the next Sunday when we come together, and then I stick it in the offering. God, I'm writing the check before I spend anything else, and I'm going to give it. And Jen asked me, why do you write two tithe checks? I said, because I got two paychecks that week, one from this job and one from my other job. And this week, I actually knew what my paycheck was going to be at the end of the week, so I wrote my tithe check for both of them before I even got that check. Not to say I got it all together. Again, I'm not trying to say, hey, look at me, I'm perfect. No, I'm far from perfect. But I'm saying when we are out of debt and we're free, we can give like nobody else can give. We could say, you know what? I just heard that Chuck, he needs a new tire on his car. Here's $100, Chuck. Go get a new tire and a new alignment. And that's probably all you can get for that. But you know what I'm saying? You can give. I can't really do that this week, Chuck. I got a tire on my own car I got to take care of, remember? You can spend. You can enjoy your money. You can enjoy what God has given you. You can take some time in proportion. Now, if you're going on, you know, Las Vegas vacations and you're up to your eyeballs in debt, something's way out of whack. Just because you can make the payment doesn't mean you can afford it, right? But when you're debt-free, you could say, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to give. I'm going to bless God's house. I'm going to bless ministries. I'm going to see fruit come. I'm going to enjoy some of what I've earned. That's what Ecclesiastes, he's talking about. Solomon says, enjoy the things that you've earned in your time on earth. You can also save more. You can plan for a future. You can set up a retirement account. I've got a retirement account, and you know how much money I've put in it my whole life? Zero. I had an old 401k from a previous job that had an employer match. I put a little bit in there, and they matched some. And then I stopped doing that because I said, I need to get my house in order before I start saving for retirement. And then I took that 401k and I rolled it into a 403b, which I set up with the Assemblies of God. And every year, our district, because I pay tithes as a minister to our district, they put a little bit of money into that account for me. So every month when I get the statement, I joke around, we can retire now, Mel. You know, there's not much money in that account. There's almost nothing. Why? Because I'm not at the point where I can I got to take care of my life. I got to take care of my debts. I got to take care of feeding my family. I should plan for my future, but I've got to take care of right now. But when you're debt-free, you can say, I'm going to put some money so that I can retire. Dave Ramsey says all the time, retire with dignity, right? I've run into so many people working at Sam's that are of retirement age, and they're not working at Sam's to have something to do to get out of the house. They're working at Sam's because they said, oh, I got Social Security coming, and I'll be able to make it off of that. And you know what? Every year it seems less and less is coming out of Social Security. And now they say, you know what? To even eat, I got to get a job, but I can't get too good of a job or else they'll cut my Social Security. So they live in this catch-22 where they've got to have 18- and 19-year-old managers telling them what to do when they've worked for a lifetime and they didn't save and they can't retire with dignity and they can't get ahead because they can't make too much because what they got will be cut. We don't want to live that way. I don't think God wants us to live that way. That's why I'm saying to you today, young people, save some money. Don't spend all you have. As best as you can, stay out of debt. Even to go to school. I'm just saying, I've learned some lessons because now I've been out of school for 13 years. And guess what? I'm still making student loan payments. Why? Because I said, I'll pay it off later. I'm young and stupid. I'm going to borrow up to my eyeballs to get a degree, right? Some things you learn down the road, right? Why is it all important? We believe 2 Timothy 3:16 says that all scripture is God-breathed and is what? Useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. So when we say God's word talks about money, well, 2 Timothy 3:16 tells me that's useful to me. And if I want to apply it to my life, then it will be beneficial to my life. Again, Proverbs 21:20 tells me that fools devour all they have. So if I'm going to avoid being foolish, I've got to stop spending all that I have, live on less than I make, and make a plan for my money. Is that simple? We can do that. The second thing I want you to see today, oh, I'm running out of time. Fools are lazy. Fools are lazy. Uh-oh. Proverbs 21, verses 25 and 26. What the sluggard desires will kill him. Now, what's a sluggard? It's not a person that looks like a slug, not like a you know, Jabba the Hutt person. That's not a sluggard. A sluggard is a person that is lazy, all right? The desires of that sluggard will kill him, for his hands refuse to work. What? I mean, I can't just play PlayStation all day and live? No, you got to work. All day long, he craves greedily. But the righteous gives and does not hold back. Why? I believe this proverb is saying that the righteous person has applied the wisdom of God and now is amply supplied, so they are able to give to people without even thinking about it. There was a time Mel and I were in a previous church, and we felt both of us at the same time without even talking came and said, I really think we need to give so-and-so some money. At that time, I worked a job that paid very well, as well as doing ministry. They took care of my housing and insurance. I had to work to put food on my table, so I went and got a job. I worked at a car dealership, managed a rental department, and they paid me well to do that job. And at that time, we were doing pretty good, and I said, we both said at the same time, same person, same amount. And I said, okay, this is God. So I went and wrote out the check and put it in a card. It was around the holidays, and we were going to bless this person. And we were trying to do it anonymously, you know, where you just take the card and you kind of slip it to where they're going to get it without them. We didn't want them to know it was us. And so we were just trying to bless them and be a blessing. And I had put that in and sealed up the card with the envelope. And I went and was going out the front door to put a diaper in the diaper genie. And our kids were real little. And someone had come by and stuck the exact amount of money anonymously to us. And as I looked through our budget of what we needed, we actually didn't have that money that month to give. I thought we did, because at the time I wasn't as budgeted as I am now. And so I had thought we had it, and we didn't. And God knew that we wanted to give and had the heart to give. And so he made it to where that giving was not a curse on us, because we would have been in lack. And he provided. And that's why the righteous says that you can give and not hold back, but the sluggard, the lazy person, sits around all day not wanting to work, and what do they want? They want more. The TV they have is not good enough, so they want a bigger one, a better one. The game station they got is not good enough, so they want a new one. The phone they've got isn't good enough, so they've got to go and get a new one. And what they don't realize is that desire for more without the desire to work for it will eventually put you under. The sluggard desires, and it will kill him. All day long, he craves greedily. Greed is dangerous because it causes people to do unspeakable things. When you allow your flesh and your desire to motivate your life rather than the word of God, you're putting yourself on shaky ground. Why? Greed destroys families. Greed destroys marriages. Greed destroys relationships. Greed can destroy opportunities at your job. Because you're known as the guy that will do anything to get ahead. Desire in the form of greed is a bad motivator. But good desire is a good motivator. That's what Proverbs says in 16:26. It says this, a laborer's appetite works on his behalf, for his hunger urges him to work. I was watching a survival show the other day, Survivor Man. Anybody ever watch Survivor Man on Science Channel? This Canadian guy gets dropped off in desolate places. And it's not really, it shouldn't be called Survivor Man. It should be called Live on as Little as I Can and Whine About It for an Hour Man. Because that dude never has enough to eat. He's like, oh, I found this little grub inside this log. I'm going to eat it. And it's a good protein. but I burned 3,000 calories today. Here's about 5. I'm going to take that in. I'm good to go. Good night's sleep tonight. But Survivor Man, he was going out hunting. And he says, I like to hunt on an empty stomach because that hunger in me hones my senses so that I can try and do better. And I heard the same thing on Alaska, the last frontier. These guys go out to hunt, and they're trying to just subsistence live in Alaska. They've got to get food in the freezer to feed their family for the winter. And he says, I hunt hungry. It hones my, and like, that's because the laborer's appetite drives him on. If I know I've got to work to put food on the table, I'm going to work harder to make sure I got something to eat. That's good desire. Bad desire leads to your destruction. Good desire puts you where you want to go. Proverbs chapter 24, verses 30 to 34 says, when I passed by the field of the sluggard, by the vineyard of the one who lacks judgment, I saw that thorns had grown up all over it. The ground was covered in weeds, and its stone wall was broken down. When I saw this, I gave careful consideration to it. I received instruction from what I saw. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to relax, and your poverty will come like a bandit, and your need like an armed robber. When you realize that my laziness will lead to my destruction, but my hard work will lead to my benefit, you say, that's what I want to do. I want to work hard. I'm glad that my parents instilled a good work ethic in me. I was talking to my cousin last week about this. And when we were younger, my uncle managed a restaurant in Lawrence down on Mass Street called the Grinder Man. It was a sub shop. And we were talking, and I said, man, the only thing I remember about when you guys lived in Lawrence was going to eat meatball subs at the Grinder Man because they were delicious. I still remember them. I was probably not even 10 years old at the time, I think. And I still remember these meatball subs. And my cousin told me his memory of that place was this. His dad would let him come to work, and he would bus tables, and he would work hard. He would clean tables off. He would throw trash away. He would do all that he needed to do. And he still, to this day, remembers the first check his dad wrote. Instead of giving him the cash, he wrote out a check. He put his name on it. It was from the Grinder Man. And he still remembers my first paycheck, $40. And you think, $40, that's not much money. But when you're a kid, $40, especially when we were kids, $40 could buy you some stuff, right? And he said he still remembers that his dad said, okay, now we're going to take that, and $4 is going to go in the offering. And my cousin's like, what? And at this young age, he remembers the first paycheck, and he remembers the first lesson on tithing. You see how that works? In his mind, he equated, I work, I get money. I get money, I'm going to give it to God. And now my cousin, that had to be 25 plus years ago. And now, you know what? It doesn't surprise me that he works hard to feed his family. And when I think about, you know, all the lawns that I've mowed, all the children that I've babysat growing up before I could legally have a job, how many times I would have that dollar or that $2 tithe to put in the offering on Sunday because I'd earned 10 or 20 bucks that week. And you know what? Have I loved every job that I had? No. Far from it. But my parents instilled in me this thing. You look at the sluggard, and his desires lead him to ruin. But the appetite of the worker drives him on. Let us not be lazy. Let us strive to say, God, you have given me an ability and a mind. Let me have wisdom, knowledge, and understanding so that I can put some things ahead. Our time has run out. We are going to finish this message next week. So if you want to hear a little bit more about the fool and his money, join us next week. Let's stand together. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today, Lord God. I know that that many of us, Lord, including myself, we have made financial mistakes. Lord, we have not acted wisely as your word has taught us. But Father, I believe that you are calling us here to this place, to this time, so that we can put some more tools in our belt so we can plan for a better future. Right now, Lord, I think of the finances of this house, of this church. And Lord, we have been living in need and in lack for too long. And Father, I believe that you have given these words to your people today so that as we are getting ourselves in a better financial footing, Lord, we can give more to the needs of this house and of this community, Lord, so that lost people can be saved here and around the world. Lord, I think of the sad fact that we have not supported our missionaries fully. for too long. And Lord, I repent of that. Lord, you want us to support missions so that people can know your word. Father, help us. Lord, as we are looking this day and even next week, Father, help us to have the tools to act like the wise. Lord, we know your word says, if you walk with the wise, you grow wise. Lord, let us stop acting like fools and suffering the harm for it, I pray, Lord God. Lord, help us, I pray. If you would just repeat out of me, Father, forgive me for the foolish things I've done. Lord, help me to apply your word and walk in wisdom. Jesus, give me the faith to trust you first. In Jesus' name. Lord, I thank you. I pray that you'd help us to apply that to our lives this week, Lord. Let our foundation be that we are hearers and doers of your word, and we're on a firm foundation. Father, as we look at our finances and our money, let us walk with the wise and grow wise. We ask it in Jesus' name.